Hello, this is Stacy from JesusMinistries.co.uk. I just wanted to share with you all that a dream that I've had, and I want you to know first that 99% of my dreams are never shared with anyone except my husband, and that's only the ones that the Lord really impresses on my heart ever make it to the public. This is one of those dreams that the Lord has impressed on my heart. So, as I was chewing on this and kind of figuring out how I would say it and how I would make the application that this dream has, which is relevant to all believers, and I got comfortable with it in my head because I don't really like speaking much, and so I was trying to be as clear as possible. Suddenly, good grief, God just dropped fire in my bones, and my eyes saw something about the dream that I had never seen before. And it became even a matter of believer's blood on my hands if I didn't share this dream. So this is why I've taken the copyright off of this video, because I want lives to be saved. You can take this video, upload it to your own YouTube channel, put it on WhatsApp, Instagram, Rumble, Facebook, whatever social media you're on. It's very urgent. The message is very urgent. And this will be a matter of life and death for multitudes of believers. And this is especially relevant for 2022 and onwards. And you'll see what I mean as I share. If you do copy this video and download it and upload it somewhere else, please, please, please also copy the first paragraph in the description, or all the description if you would like. But at least the first paragraph, and put it in either the comments or the description of wherever you're copying it to social media, so people can still follow it back to the original content. And if they want to contact me, they can. I hate it, guys, when I see a video that's been copied from somewhere and there's absolutely no way to know where this came from, who is behind it, or anything. So please do honor my video by putting those links wherever you upload it. The message tied to this interpretation was really out of my comfort zone, but I got three confirmations by three different people that this is absolutely what I'm supposed to be sharing. One of those confirmations was from my husband, who just one day grabbed the camera and went to the beach and just shot a film. He didn't tell me what he was gonna film. I had no idea until I actually watched his video, and my jaw literally dropped to the ground because he was saying the words that I was thinking. And this was after God had put in my spirit what I was supposed to be saying about this video. And I hadn't told him what I was going to say about this video. He just knew the dream, and that was it. So his video is a 15-minute, really powerful video. And I'll put that also in the description links, so you can find that there. It's really good. You should go watch it. So I'm first going to tell you my dream, then its interpretation, then I have a few words to say. But first, let's pray and bring this before our Heavenly Father. Oh Lord God, thank you so much for using me as your vessel. Father, I praise your name, I worship you. You alone are worthy to be praised. Let Jesus be glorified in this word, and let my tongue speak only truth from you. Father, I pray that you would just give me wisdom to know how to present this. And Lord, I also pray for the hearers, that they would all be vessels for you, that this would put passionate fire in their bones, and that you would open their eyes to see new things, and that you would put a drive inside of their spirits that would just make them seek you more than ever before, speak your words, hear your words, and actually walk it out in faith, in actions. Thank you for everything you've done for us. Bless this video, Lord. In Jesus' name I pray. And Father, I pray that millions of lives would be saved because of it. Already, those who are already Christians, and you know they're right on the verge of making a decision that will bring either life or death, I pray this video would make it to them, and that their lives would be never the same, that they would choose life. Thank you, in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, so my dream... Sorry guys, I'm just overwhelmed. My dream was, we were in the sea My whole family was not in the sea, but we were like in the middle of a sea. It was gray, overcast clouds, gray sea. It was a calm day, gray water. And very strangely, all around this sea or ocean, whatever it was, for as far as you could see, there were little paths that were about a foot wide and stretched out this way and that way. Sometimes they forked, sometimes they went up a bit, sometimes they went down, they went this way, that way. So the whole sea was full of these little paths. And they were only wide enough for one person to walk on. There's no way you could pass another person walking the opposite direction. So our family was walking on these paths, tiled paths, in the middle of the sea. And we got to a point where we knew we weren't supposed to be on this path anymore. We didn't know where we were supposed to be. We looked around and we saw about a football field's length away across all this open sea, another set of paths that were going this way and that way. And we knew we were supposed to be over there now. Like the time for us to finish this path had come, even though the path continued that we were on. We knew we were no longer supposed to continue on this path. We were supposed to be on the other side. Well, in all this time, there was a massive black sea monster that was terrifying. Its body was the size of a small house, and it was under the water, and its head was just absolutely black and hideous and terrifying. You could feel the presence of this beast. I guess you could call it a beast, sea monster. You could feel its presence. It was pure evil. And it had an assignment to take us out. Its job was to destroy us. As we were walking the paths, before we got to this point where we knew we shouldn't be there anymore, this thing would be there and then sometimes it wouldn't be there. It was like it had other responsibilities, and sometimes it wasn't watching us, it just disappeared completely. Sometimes it was there. As long as we were on that path that we were supposed to be, it couldn't touch us. Even though it looked physically like it could, you know, it could have just jumped up and gobbled us, but it was like it wasn't allowed to even dare touch us. So we got to this point and we looked across the water and we had just thought, we have to swim from this side all the way to that side. This sea monster was disappearing and appearing, and we were just listening to the Holy Spirit. When should we go? We were saying, when, Lord, should we go? When do you want us to swim across this great open expanse of sea and get to the other side? So we were looking and waiting and talking with each other, and then the Holy Spirit said, okay, go now. And we looked up to go, and this sea monster was right in front of us. It was terrifying. We were all shaking, and we knew the Lord had told us to go. So we all swam one at a time. I don't know why we had to swim one at a time, but in the dream we could only swim one person at a time. So as I just kept my eyes exactly on the path I knew I was supposed to be on. I was praying like crazy the whole way. I did not even look at the sea monster. I couldn't, because I knew if I looked at that thing, I would drown, because I would just freeze in terror and I would just get drowned. So straight across I went. Then my husband, my children, each one went across. When we got to the other side, we were so relieved. We looked back. The sea monster was still there. It hadn't moved. And then the Holy Spirit told us in our heart, he just said three words, it's a decoy. And then I woke up from the dream. So, I woke up so terrified. I was so scared. I didn't even want to go back to sleep for fear of continuing this dream because it was so scary. So now the interpretation, let's just go right into that. The tiled paths across the ocean are paths of life. God has a specific path for each one of us in life. So as we follow, he gives us choices. But sometimes he says he'll bless whatever path we take. He gives us that choice. Sometimes he tells us specifically that we are supposed to choose one path over another. So it's a choice of obedience and disobedience. So in this dream, our family came to a point where the path continued, but God made it quite clear in our hearts that he wanted us to be now on another path. And he wanted us to be specifically on the path across the water, which we had to swim through open sea to reach. And it was a simple choice of obedience. We were all absolutely terrified. We literally chose to die and obey because we couldn't see how we could possibly live swimming across this thing that had a mandate to kill us. So we didn't know how we could possibly live. It was terrifying. This thing was hunting us, and we decided we're gonna go to our death obeying God. You know, he told us to do this, we're just gonna do this. We don't know how this is gonna work. We're gonna follow. This reminds me of the verse in John 12, 25 through 26. It says, whoever loves his life will lose it, but whoever hates his life in this world will keep it for eternal life. If anyone serves me, he must follow me. He must follow me. Did you hear that, guys? He must follow me. And where I am, my servant will be as well. If anyone serves me, the Father will honor him. So you have to honor God by your obedience if you're actually following him. And I knew this path that we would be on, the new path when we got across the sea, was full of abundance and full of more, and God was going to use us in better and greater ways. So we obeyed and we chose to focus on the path we were supposed to be on and not the sea monster we were passing. And I told you I wouldn't have been able to kind of complete my mission of getting to the other side if I had looked at this scary thing instead of focusing on what I was supposed to be doing. So this dream has two sides to it. One side I saw myself, and the other side the Lord dropped fire in my bones to show me, and that's what I'm kind of uncomfortable sharing, but I'm going to share it in obedience. So the first side of this dream is that if you follow the Holy Spirit and obey what he tells you to do, you will be safe. There is always safety in obedience, even if it looks scary. And the second side of this is that if you choose disobedience, it may actually cost you your physical life. I will say especially in 2022. Sorry, guys, I'm just trembling. I'm overwhelmed because this word was confirmed and I just know it's true. And it's scary. It's that scary as true. Because of the intensity of this time period in history we're in right now, everything is more intense. Your actions of obedience will have more intense good rewards, good consequences, you could say. Your acts of disobedience will have much more severe bad consequences. In fact, it could cost you your life, even though you don't know it, even though you can't see it. Don't choose safety over obedience. So, is there a sea monster in your life right now? And you have to choose between obedience, which looks like death, it looks like a death sentence to you, or are you going to choose to obey? Because God will save your life if you choose to obey him. Whatever path you choose, just know that it will affect other people around you as well, not just yourself, whether you know it or not. We'll come back to that in a second. Right, now buckle your seatbelts. We're going to go back this up with more stuff that the Lord gave me. It just blew my mind when he was just bringing these things to my mind. We're going to go to scripture. Some of the stories you've maybe never heard before, just four quick stories. And I really want to drive this point home because you will be choosing possibly death if you choose disobedience. If God is asking you to do something in your life and you're just terrified, maybe because you can't, maybe it means the death of your job. Maybe it means the death of separation from your family. Maybe it means you don't know how you're going to pay your bills. You don't know how you're going to eat this month if you make this decision. Maybe it means the death of a reputation. You might have worked for decades to build a business with a reputation. And God is asking you to do something that might, it looks like the whole thing that you've built of years will just come tumbling down if you obey. I can tell you that God is more interested in you and your future than you will ever be. And he wants life for you. If he's asking you to do something, don't doubt it. Obey. So first of all, I want to say all dreams should be tested by checking if the message is backed by scripture. And I also want to mention that God gives different kinds of dreams. Some dreams are for you to prepare for what God is about to do. Some dreams are to warn you what the enemy is planning so you can pray against those things that he's showing you. And some of them are for your encouragement to strengthen your walk in the Lord. So with that thought, we're just going to go into these different stories. The first story is in Daniel 6. And it tells the story of, and I'm just going to paraphrase the whole thing just so we can quickly get through this. It tells the story of a jealous man plotting against Daniel because he was being lifted up by God. Because of his amazing wisdom, the king took notice of Daniel and he had planned to set him over the entire kingdom. They knew Daniel was absolutely devoted to God. So they set a trap by way of a 30-day decree or edict, if you will. And they said, if anyone worships anyone but King Darius, he should be thrown into the lion's den. Daniel chose death over disobedience. He chose death rather than violate his own God-given conscience, because choosing to pray to God and not Darius meant death. And I don't think Daniel ever knew of anyone else escaping the lion's den. With life. So he chose death over disobedience. He chose to obey and go to his death. You must know how the story goes. Daniel continued to pray to God, not the king, and was thrown into the pit of lions. The next day he was pulled out completely unharmed. God had shut the mouth of the lions because of Daniel choosing death and obedience. He lived. Not only that, King Darius sent out a decree commanding all of his kingdom to fear and tremble before the God of Daniel, because he is the living God who endures forever. So because of Daniel's obedience, the heathen king himself spread the message that Daniel's God was the only God to worship. When you face a sea monster and you obey the voice of God, you are preaching God. Obedience to God is always preaching God to others. It doesn't matter if you can see the results immediately or decades from now. Obedience is always preaching God. The second story is in Daniel 3, and it's King Nebuchadnezzar set up an absolutely massive statue and made a law that everyone should fall down and worship it when they heard music. So when the music played and three men out of the masses of people were just standing there refusing to bow, the king was enraged. When he questioned them, they had a simple answer for their actions. And they said, "O King Nebuchadnezzar, we have no need to answer you in this matter. If God," and this is verse 17 of chapter 3, "if the God whom we serve exists, then he is able to deliver us from the blazing fiery furnace and from your hand, O king," because there was a law, you get chucked into the fire if you don't bow down. "So even if he does not save us, let it be known to you, O king, that we will not serve your gods or worship the golden statue that you have set up." Totally infuriated, the king had them all bound and chucked into the fire. The fire was so hot, its flames killed the guards who were chucking them in. You know the story. The king saw four people in the flames, not three. And he says, "One of them looks like the son of the gods." So he called, the king called out to these three men, and they came out. The king was amazed that not even their clothes had the smell of singed clothing. There was not even a smell of smoke on them. The king sent out a decree that anyone who spoke evil of this God who rescued these men would be cut to pieces and their houses turned to rubble. Those three men chose death over disobedience. They chose death, and they chose, "We are going to obey God to the death." They did not violate their God-given conscience. They chose to obey. So God not only gave them life, he used them to change the king's heart so that the heathen king would actually preach God with this decree to the entire land. One action of obedience can have more good consequences than you can even imagine. If you make yourself available to be used by God, and this is what my husband's message was, that's why it just totally blew me away when I heard it. When you make yourself available to be used by God, however he will use you, your life will never be the same. He might ask you to do scary things, but he is more concerned about you than even you yourself will ever be. He's more concerned about your children than you will ever be. He's more concerned about your parents. He's more concerned about your grandparents than you will ever be. Obey him, whatever he's asking you to do, obey him. Now we're going to look at some examples of disobedience. And by the way, there are loads and loads of stories in scripture to back these up. I just picked a few that came to mind because we'd be here for hours if I just kept going and going. There are so many stories. You probably never heard this one before, but it's enough to put the fear of God into anybody. In 1 Chronicles 21, it says, "Then Satan," and this is verse 1, "then Satan rose up against Israel and incited David to take a census of Israel." David knew taking a census was wrong. This is something God had told them not to do. They weren't to count the people. This was the job of the priest sometimes. David knew this was wrong. In fact, it was so wrong, even his top commander pleaded with him, "Do not do this evil thing before the Lord," and even said something to the effect of, "Why are you putting this guilt on Israel?" David totally ignored these pleas and stubbornly demanded that his census be taken. So Joab, the head commander, did an intentionally sloppy job of taking the census. He left off the tribes of Levi and Benjamin because this job was so detestable to him. He was forced to do something that he hated. And maybe Joab should have stood his ground and absolutely refused, but he did his best to sway David. Right, what happened next, and these are my own words, was God roared against David and he gave him three choices of punishment. You can read this. The three choices of punishment for doing this evil thing were 1, 3 years of famine, 2, 3 months of outside attackers drawing the sword and troubling Israel, or 3 days of the sword of the Lord by a plague upon the land. At this point, David was heartbroken because he knew he had totally disobeyed God and done something completely evil, and he chose in his heartbrokenness to get it over as fast as possible. He chose 3 days, and 70,000 men died in 3 days. Sorry, guys. The whole nation was plunged into mourning all at once. David saw a massive angel, huge, standing between heaven and earth with a sword drawn. And he cried out to God, "Stop, stop, stop, please stop." And he said, "What have these innocent people done? It was me that did this sin." So David chose willful disobedience. He chose not only to violate his own conscience, but he gave his commander a job to do that violated his conscience as well, and probably the consciences of all the men that had to do this census. It didn't result in just one death. 70,000 men died in 3 days. It resulted in families being plunged into mourning all at once, children losing their daddies, wives losing their husbands, parents losing their children. Innocent men dying. This story should put the fear of God in you. If you sin, your disobedience won't affect just you. It affects many. Whether you see it or not, other people will be affected by your disobedience. And especially right now in history, you know, the governments are trying to force things on the people. And they're using, like, dodgy ways of doing it. Bribery and, you know, saying, if you don't do this, you won't have a job. If you don't do this, this. If you won't do this, this. You know, they're trying to force you. Don't give in. Do what you know is right. Don't violate your God-given conscience. It might mean your death, your physical death in 2022. Pray for your life. And also, pray that God uses you and gives you the strength to walk in obedience. It's a tough thing sometimes, but God will always give you the strength if you ask Him. All right, the fourth story is in 1 Samuel chapters 13 through 15. Saul is king, and he's been given commands by God to fulfill. He made two very bad choices. The first one was doing the job given to only priests and prophets by offering up a sacrifice, because the prophet was late in making it to this event, so Saul just decided that he would offer the sacrifice since the prophet wasn't there on time. So the other was that he feared the people. That was his first mistake. The second one was that he feared the people, so he disobeyed when God had told him to kill all the inhabitants of a certain area. It says that God was sorry after that he had made Saul king. Saul feared the people. How can you fear the people over God? When you fear people over God, it will always bring destruction on your head. Don't fear people when you have the God of heaven and earth, the God of the universe, with you. You should never fear people when God is with you. So, because Saul chose to disobey God and violate his own God-given conscience, the entire kingdom of Israel was ripped from him. It was ripped from his descendants because the Lord chose another king. Saul's disobedience ended not only in his own death, but the death of his son and countless men who died in the final battle that they fought against another country because God was no longer fighting for him. The Bible is full of more examples, but we'll be here for a long time if we go forever going through them. So I'm going to make a page for the Sea Monster Dream on my husband's ministry website, which is jesusministries.co.uk, and the link will be in the description. I'll also embed some videos of modern day people that have stood for Jesus and chosen to obey rather than disobey, and then the consequences. So, what is the cost of following God for you? Is God asking you to do something that might destroy your business reputation? Jesus was hanging out with sinners and tax collectors. He didn't have a very good reputation. His reputation was terrible, actually, amongst the religious people. But his success was not measured by his reputation. It was measured by the results of his obedience. God always desires obedience. So I saved the best for last, but before that, I just want to say, if you're facing a sea monster in your life and you'd like prayer, please go to our ministry website, jesusministries.co.uk. There's and in that page about the sea monster dream, leave a comment at the bottom. My husband and I will pray for you. We are believing that tons of people will be blessed by this dream. It really shook me when I got this. I wasn't expecting to say this stuff. I was just expecting to say, if you follow the Holy Spirit, you'll be safe. But God said, no, 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 you say the rest of it. And he just gave me all this stuff to say. That's really kind of rattling to the bones. And I hope it saves you. If you're facing this, I hope you make the right decision. We will pray for you on our website. Leave a comment under the video. But because I've made this video public to go all over the place, there's a good chance that we may never find your comments. So if you go to our ministry website, we will definitely pray for you there. And by the way, guys, pray for each other in the comments. If you see somebody asking for prayer, please, all of you as brothers and sisters, pray for each other in the comments. Let's build each other up, strengthen each other. These are perilous times, and they mean they need people, leaders rising up to say, this is the word of the Lord. He said he will never leave you or forsake you, and bless each other in the name of the Lord. So we are all members of one body of Christ. Don't forget to help each other. So I'm going to go now to the cherry on top. So I had forgotten about these scriptures, and then the Lord just brought this to mind right at the end of putting all this together. And in Deuteronomy 28, it says, there are two sections to this. I'll just explain quickly. One is about all the blessings you will have if you obey. And then the next section is all the curses you have if you don't obey. And I believe these verses are intensified so much in 2022 that literally those who are going to be obeying the Lord, if you obey the Lord, he will take care of you. He will give you abundance beyond what you can even imagine. He'll do things you could never imagine. If you disobey, you try to save your life because you're just scared that you're going to die if you don't do something. You're going to lose your job. You're going to lose your business. If you do that, there's tons of curses. Don't do that. Please don't do that. Okay, let me just read this. I'm getting off on rabbit trails now. So this is verse 1. It says, now if you faithfully obey the voice of the Lord your God, and you carefully follow all his commandments I'm giving you today, the Lord your God will set you on high above the nations of the earth, and all these blessings will come upon you and overtake you if you will obey the voice of your God. And let's just go through these. It says, you will be blessed in the city and blessed in the country. The fruits of your womb will be blessed, as well as the produce of your land, and the offspring of your livestock and your calves, the calves of your herds and the lambs of your flocks. Your basket and your kneading bowl will be blessed. You will be blessed when you come in and blessed when you go out. The Lord will cause your enemies who rise up against you to be defeated before you. They will march out against you in one direction, but flee from you in seven. The Lord will decree a blessing on your barns and on everything to which you put your hand. You hear that? Everything which you put your hand to, God will bless if you obey him. If. This is a conditional blessing. If you obey him, he will bless everything that your hand touches. I just want to say, real quickly, I believe there are people that are listening to this video. When you choose to obey, God is going to put you in places of government. God is going to put you in high places in the medical community, in education. God is going to lift you up in those branches, in financial institutions. God is going to put you in seats of honor because you have been obedient to God. Obey, 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 and you will be lifted up. People in the sector of arts and entertainments, if you obey, if you proclaim Jesus is Lord by your obedience, whatever he is telling you to do, he will lift you up. So let me continue on. The Lord will establish you as a holy people, just as he has sworn to you, if you keep the commandments of the Lord your God and walk in his ways. Then all the peoples of earth will see that you are called by the name of the Lord, and they will stand in awe of you. Do you hear that? They will stand in awe of you because you have chosen to obey. So the Lord will make you prosper. This is verse 11 in Deuteronomy 28. The Lord will make you prosper abundantly in the fruit of your womb, the offspring of your livestock, the produce of your land, in the land the Lord has sworn to your fathers. The Lord will open up the heavens, his abundant storehouse, to send rain on your land in season, to bless all the work of your hands. You will lend to many nations, but not borrow from them. Do you see that? No lack. And this is a national blessing. because of your obedience, the whole nation can be blessed. If every single person listening to this video makes a vow, you don't need to make a vow. Jesus said, let your yes be yes and your no be no. In your heart, just tell the Lord, I will obey you no matter what. I choose to obey you. Then nations will change. The Lord will make you the head and not the tail. You will only move upward and never downward. If you hear and carefully follow the commandments of the Lord your God, which I'm giving you today, do not turn aside to the right or to the left from any of the words I command you today. Do not go after other gods and serve them. Are you guys, is anybody here watching TV personalities? Are you doing your makeup like celebrities because you want to be like them? Stop it. This is idolatry. Do not do this. Are you glued to the news? Stop it. Turn the news off. This is idolatry. And God cannot use you if you are swallowed up in idolatry because you can't hear his voice because you've let all this noise into your head. Let God be your God. It might be little silly things that are idolatry. Just make the Lord your God the most important thing in your life. Talk to him all day long as you go out your day. Ask him what you should be doing. Thank him for everything that you have. Thank him for your life if you feel like you don't have anything else to thank him for. There's always something. Okay, off on a rabbit trail now. Let me get back to the point. So, this is verse 15 now of Deuteronomy 28, and these are the curses. And guys, I couldn't believe it. The curses go on for pages and pages and pages. I'm not even going to read all of them, but these are so scary. I hope it puts the fear of God in you. And by the way, in Proverbs, it says, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. Sometimes God gives us nice little words of encouragement. Sometimes he gets us a slap across the face. And when he does that, we have to listen because it's serious business if you disobey. So this is a kind of like slap across the face. Verse 15, if, however, you do not obey the Lord your God by following carefully all of his commands and statutes I'm giving you today, these curses will come upon you and they will overtake you. You will be cursed in the city and cursed in the country. Your basket and kneading bowl will be cursed. The fruits of your womb will be cursed, as well as the produce of your land, the calves of your herds, the lambs of your flock will be cursed. You will be cursed when you come in. You will be cursed when you go out. The Lord will send curses upon you, confusion and reproof. Confusion is a curse. Did you hear that? Confusion is a curse. And reproof, in all to which you put your hand. So everything you put your hand to, nothing is prospering if you're cursed, until you are destroyed and quickly perish because of the wickedness in you that you have committed in forsaking him. The curses actually go on for pages and pages. Like I said, I'm not going to read them all. That was enough. And you can read this all in Deuteronomy 28. I just want to say, do not disobey the Lord. Because of the time we're in, I've said this over and over, it could cost you your life. God is weeding out wishy-washy Christians right now from the church because he's got serious work for the body of Christ to do, and he wants people he can trust. God can't use you if you're wishy-washy and you can't stand and you can't take orders from him. You can't obey, even if it looks scary. So all Christians are in a spiritual battle right now. I'm sure you know that. This is not news. Make your life a decree of God by your obedience, and then God will use your actions and faith to decree himself to the world. We just read that. He will decree himself to the world. The whole world will stand in awe of you because you are shining out the light of Jesus. So I just want to say thank you for watching this. This is about it. I'll just do maybe a quick summary at the end. And then we'll finish. So please subscribe if you aren't subscribed. This is my knitting and cooking channel though, like it's a craft channel. So if you subscribe to this channel, you will probably be seeing like knitting and crafts, and that's what I normally put on this channel. But if you only want to hear words from the Lord and dreams and whatever else God has put on my husband and my heart to share, then please go to our ministry YouTube channel, which is called Jesus Ministries UK. But because we're shadow banned, it seems like, on YouTube for saying things, I don't know. But it'll only come up if you type in Jesus Ministries Frederico. So if you type in my husband's name, Frederico, with Jesus Ministries, it will come up. I have two more thoughts. Just in closing, as I was talking, these just came to me, so we're going to flow with the Holy Spirit. If you're a witch, a warlock, or a wizard, or you're attached in any way to dark things similar to that, maybe you've even sold your soul to Satan and you don't know how to get out and you desperately want to get out, let me tell you, Jesus paid for your life with his blood. You know about blood sacrifices. You know how powerful blood is. Jesus paid for you with blood. The price is already paid, it's already finished, it's just a matter of you saying, yes, I want to be free. Not being able to get out of those groups is a lie from Satan. And this is the deception. This deception is the only one he has a hold on. He doesn't have anything else. He has to try and deceive you, because everybody would just be coming out with the blood of Jesus. So this is a total deception and lie by him. You're already bought and paid with by the blood of Jesus. You just need to accept it. So the blood of Jesus is more powerful than any animal sacrifice. It's more powerful than your dark high priest or priestess. It's more powerful than demons. The blood of Jesus has the power to shake the heavens and the earth. Right now, just whatever comes to your mind right now, renounce it. If this is something evil that you have done or involved with, renounce it before God. Say, sorry, God. I don't want to do this anymore. I'm sorry I've grieved you. Forgive me. That's all you have to do. And with your whole heart, your whole soul, and your whole mind, give your life to Jesus, and he will change you. You will never be the same. He'll wrap you up in his love, and he'll fill you with his Holy Spirit, and you will become a new creation in Christ. Also, get a Bible if you don't already have one and read it. A good place to start is John, the book of John, chapters 14 through 17, and these will just wrap you up in his love. God loves you so much, and all that stuff that you've been through in these dark things have left scars and wounds. God will heal all those in Jesus' name. Lord, I pray your healing on anyone who has wounds that need healed, physical wounds and spiritual wounds and emotional wounds. However this is, whatever these wounds are, heal them, Lord God, in your name. And fill them with your Holy Spirit, fill them with your love, and let them find someone who is willing to mentor them face to face. In Jesus' name I pray this. Amen. And just a quick thought, it's important to be mentored, and not all churches even know how to deal with people that have had a lot of demonic contact, because they themselves aren't operating in the power of God that he has given them. But if you pray to Jesus and you ask him to bring someone into your life that will help you, guide you, mentor you, love you, he will bring that person into your life. Trust him and keep praying, because God is good. And if he doesn't bring someone straight away, don't worry. You just get in the Word of God. Read your Bible. And this will change your life. It will bring abundance to your life. It will change your life forever. So the second thought, some of you have already made the wrong sea monster decision, if you will. You've chosen to disobey God and run away from the sea monster in your life. If you're sorry and ask him to use you despite your decision, He will use you. You need to repent, though. You need to repent, repent, repent with all your soul, your spirit. Repent with everything in you. Disobedience is very serious, but our God is merciful. He is so loving and so full of mercy. Let me just give you one example of how repentance changed a judgment of God. And a judgment is like a curse, isn't it? It's bad stuff. The city of Nineveh was given 40 days before destruction. God sent Jonah, and he didn't say, "Oh, Nineveh, if you will repent, I won't destroy you." He never said that. That's not in the Bible. It says Jonah went to the city, and he told them, "In 40 days, God will destroy you." Now, this looks like a prophecy that never came to pass, and some people nowadays would call Jonah a false prophet if they knew this. But because prayers change God's timeline, they change judgments, they soften judgments, they delay judgments. You have the power by your repentance, by your heartfelt repentance, to soften the judgments of God, to delay the judgments of God. So the 40-day countdown was going. Judgment never happened on Nineveh. The king tore his clothes, cried out to God, repenting, throwing ashes on his head in complete total mourning, and he commanded the whole city to do that. And they even forced their animals to fast as well. So the entire city that was supposed to be destroyed in 40 days never got destroyed. Until, some scholars say 40 years later, others say it was 100 years later. So what Jonah pronounced happened eventually, but it didn't happen for those people. It happened for other people. Your heartfelt repentance can delay and can change the judgments of God. So, with this, I just want to sum everything up very quickly, and then I'll leave you with these thoughts. So, my sea monster dream, I'll go through it very quickly, the interpretation quickly, and then just very quickly a summary of what we've gone through. Just in case some of you just want like a little snippet to put on your social media and you're not sure how to how to break down all my ramblings. So, this is what I dreamed. I dreamed my family and I were in the middle of the sea. It was a gray, cloudy, overcast day. The sea was gray, the sky was gray, everything was gray and dreary. And then there were white tiled paths all across the sea, going this way and that way, forking sometimes. And there was an expanse, maybe a football field length away, and we could see across this length of open sea was more paths going here and there. As we were walking on these paths, there was a massive, terrifying sea monster. Every time I talk about this thing, I just get the creeps. It was so disturbing. There was a massive sea monster. He had a mandate. He was given a mandate to kill us, to destroy us. But as long as we were on the path that we were supposed to be on, he couldn't touch us. And as we were walking along, these paths were only big enough to walk single file. There's no way you could ever pass anyone going the opposite direction. So this sea monster was there sometimes, and then he would disappear sometimes. It's like he had other things, other responsibilities to do. And as we were walking along this path, we suddenly stopped because we knew we weren't supposed to be on it any longer. Although the path continued forward, that wasn't a problem. It was still there. But we knew we were no longer supposed to be on this. So we were looking around and our eyes fell on the path across this open expanse of water. And we knew we were supposed to be on the other side. So we didn't know what to do because the sea monster kept swimming around, giving us the creeps. And we just prayed, "Lord, when do you want us to swim across? We know we're supposed to be there. When should we go?" And we were chatting with each other and just looking around. And then suddenly the Holy Spirit said, "Okay, go now." And we looked up to go, and this sea monster was right in the middle of where we were supposed to swim. And it was huge, you guys. The body of the sea monster was underwater, but it was the size of a small house. Its head was massive, and it had a long neck. It was sticking out of the water, so we could see like its some of the back and the neck and the head right in the middle of this place where we were supposed to swim. So we knew we were supposed to be on the other side. We knew the Holy Spirit said, go now. So we made a choice to basically die and obey, because we didn't know how we could possibly live with this thing right in the middle. It was just going to eat us. So we swam one at a time. I don't know why we had to swim one at a time, but we did. We swam one at a time. And once we all focused on the path we were supposed to be on, not the sea monster. If I would have looked at that sea monster, I would have frozen and drowned right there, I can tell you, because it was so totally scary. Once we got to the other side, all of us, my husband, my children, myself, the Holy Spirit told us three words. He said, it's a decoy. So now the interpretation of this dream. And then after that, I woke up. So the interpretation is these paths through the sea are paths of life. Sometimes God leads us here and there. Sometimes God gives us choices. He says, whatever path you choose, I will bless you on. Sometimes God tells us specifically, you need to choose this path, not that path. And so to be in obedience, you have to do that. In this case, we were told to swim across the expanse, and it was scary. This sea monster obviously represents Satan or demons or something that is trying to stop you from being on God's path of life that He has for you. And whatever path He has you on will be a path full of abundance, no matter how scary it looks like it will be. So we chose death and obedience over disobedience. And four stories, very quickly, Daniel in the lion's den. Daniel chose obedience and death over disobeying when he was thrown into the lion's den, because there was a law that said you can't pray to anybody except the king for 30 days. Daniel said, never mind, I'm not doing that. I pray to God and that's it. They chucked him in the lion's den because of that. He was pulled out the next morning, totally unharmed. And the king was so happy Daniel wasn't hurt and so shocked, because the king had wanted to put Daniel above the whole kingdom, ruler of the whole kingdom, and evil men had made this plot to kill Daniel. So the king sent out an edict that says, everybody fear and tremble before the God of Daniel, the God who saved this man from the lion's den. Oh, and then by the way, the king had all of these evil plotters and their wives and their children all chucked into the lion's den. And it says before they even hit the ground of this lion's den, they were all devoured. So these were some freaking scary lions, let me tell you. The next story is Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. King Nebuchadnezzar set up a massive statue of gold and said, anytime the music plays, everybody on their faces, bow before it and worship it. And if you don't, I'll chuck you into the fire and you'll die. So when the music played, three men were left standing, twiddling their thumbs, and they weren't about to bow. And the king said, what are you doing? They said, we're not going to bow to your statue. God will save us from the fire. And even if He doesn't, we're still not bowing to your statue. We serve God and that's it. So the king had him chucked into the fire. The guards died because the fire was so hot, it killed them. And then once they got them in the fire, it looked like four people were in the fire. It says, and the king was shocked. He says, four people are in there now, and they're walking around like they're not hurt. And one of them looks like the son of God's. The king called them out. They were completely unharmed. These three men were a testimony to God's power. And in amazement, the king sent out, similar to the other story, a decree across the whole land that says nobody say anything evil about these three men's God. because he saved him from the fire. If anyone speaks evil of him, I will cut them to pieces and make their houses rubble. So everybody again was fearing the God of these three men. The next story, these are stories of obedience. When you obey God, no matter how scary it is, no matter if it means losing your life, you will gain it because God will keep you safe. Even if you're terrified, if it means losing your job, follow God if he's telling you to obey him and do something that looks scary. If it means losing your business, if it means losing your reputation, whatever God is telling you, obedience will always produce blessing. Always, always, always. The next two stories are disobedience and what they caused. So the first one is of David. David wanted a census of the land of Israel, which was totally evil. He knew it was wrong. His commander knew it was wrong and pleaded, please don't put this guilt on the heads of Israel, on the country of Israel. So David totally disregarded that and demanded that he still take a census. God was furious at David and gave David three choices of punishment because this was such a serious crime. He could have 3 years of famine, 3 months of outsiders coming in to attack Israel, or 3 days of the sword of the Lord, which was a plague across the land. David was totally heartbroken and he chose the quickest one to get it over with. And in 3 days, 70,000 men died. I can't even say that without crying. 70,000 men lost their lives, innocent people, because of one man's sin. When you choose disobedience in your life, it will affect other people whether you know it or not. You might be causing the death of somebody else because you're leading them astray in your disobedience. So David saw a massive angel standing between heaven and earth with a sword drawn, ready to come and attack Jerusalem. And he cried out to God, please stop, 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 please, it's me. It was my sin, not them. Please stop killing them. And the Lord relented in his mercy. But David paid the consequences with the lives of 70,000 other people and plunged the whole country into mourning instantly. So the last story is the story of Saul. Saul was king of Israel. He made two very bad choices. God had chosen him, and he did well for a lot of his time, but he made two very bad choices. One of them was he chose to sacrifice an animal at a time and place when only priests and prophets were supposed to do this. Because the prophet was late getting to this event, he chose to do it instead. And when the prophet got there, the prophet was shocked. Samuel was shocked and said, what the heck have you done? You're not supposed to do this. And then another time, Saul was supposed to kill all the inhabitants of a certain area, and he didn't. Saul feared the people because of what his guards and his commanders and army were saying. He chose not to do that, and he disobeyed God. Because he did this, God said, I am sorry I made you king. When you make God sorry that he even puts you in a position, it's always bad. It reminds me of Genesis, where God said, I was sorry I made mankind, because it says their hearts were evil day and night, and then the flood happened. That was bad. And in this case, Saul's disobedience led to his death, the death of his son, and the death of countless men that he had under him, because they lost the battle. They were just destroyed in battle really bad. Disobedience brings death. Disobedience doesn't just bring death to you. Disobedience can bring death to many people, because your sin and your obedience, both of them, will affect other people. Nothing you do affects only you, whether you think it does or not. So, those are my thoughts. Choose life. Choose obedience. And the last one is Deuteronomy 28. It says, if you choose to obey God, He will pour out blessings. It says you'll be blessed going in, blessed going out. Everything you touch will be blessed. Everything you put your hand to will be blessed. And it goes on and on. It says all of these awesome blessings. Read it, Deuteronomy 28. And then it goes on and says, but if you disobey, and then it goes through pages and pages of curses. Horrible, horrible, horrible curses. Choose life. Choose obedience. And our website is jesusministries.co.uk. If you need prayer and you have a sea monster in your life and you don't know what to do and you're just scared, you want someone to pray with you, we will pray with you and for you. And brothers and sisters, pray for the people in the comments that are asking for prayer. If you need prayer, put a comment there. And let's encourage each other. I hope this video brings life to all of you that are having trouble making a decision whether you obey or you disobey. I hope there will be no choice for you now. It'll just be crystal clear. There won't be any fog from the enemy, and you'll know exactly what you should do. Let me just pray quickly, and then this has become really long. Oh God, you are awesome, and I know that you'll use this video to speak to people's hearts. Let them choose life. Let this video be such clarity to them that there is no choice whether to disobey or obey. They just choose obedience. And those, Father, that are listening that don't know what to do, they are confused about what to do, I pray that you would bring clarity, that you would help them see what you are actually speaking to them to do. And those people that are already standing for you, they're already standing on Jesus, the solid rock. They've already passed that sea monster. They've already made the stand no matter what it takes. I pray that you would lift them up to places, high places of great authority and positions in government, positions in healthcare, great high positions in arts and entertainments, in the media, in family, in education, in every single area of society. God, I pray that you would lift these people up. You would bless them abundantly. You would let their voices become louder and stronger as they proclaim that Jesus is the one I follow, and I will not go to the right or to the left. I follow him. I do what's right. I do the things that he tells me to do. Thank you, Father, for your people. Thank you for your word, which is power to us. Thank you for teaching us to use your word, your powerful word, as we speak. And Lord, I pray that you would bless the hearers of this video, that you would bless them, bless them, bless them, bless them, and that they would choose life. In Jesus' name, amen.